باب الاعتكاف. Okay, اعتكاف means stay in the masjid for decided or for specific time. Means I make a niyyah to stay in the masjid 1 hour, 2 hour, 1 day, whatever. And then when I say that, when I make that niyyah, I have to do it. So this is what they call it, i'tikaf. And this chapter is talking about the i'tikaf.
So you can specify how long?
Yes. Or there is another niyyah. He said, make niyyah to make i'tikaf until I go out of the masjid. Means since you are in the masjid, i'tikaf. When you go, then masjid. And then the first hadith on Aisha radiallahu anha, and Rasulullah sallallahu كان يعتكف في العشر الأواخر من رمضان حتى توفاه الله عز وجل ثم اعتكف أزواجه بعده. Aisha said that Rasul sallallahu was doing i'tikaf last 10 days of Ramadan. Last 10 days of Ramadan, he stayed in the masjid, he did not go out. And after Rasulullah ﷺ passed away, all his wives start doing that. Mean during his life, his wife did not do i'tikaf in the masjid. But after he passed away, so they practiced that sunnah. So last 10 days of Ramadan, they stay in the masjid doing i'tikaf. So this is the first hadith. And there is another narration for this hadith. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعتكف في كل رمضان فإذا صلى الغداة جاء مكانه الذي اعتكف فيه. Means that hadith means رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم not doing i'tikaf only in last 10 days, the whole Ramadan. During Ramadan he stays in the masjid. Unless there is something necessary, he go out. If there is nothing necessary, he stay in the masjid. Means this is the best time for i'tikaf. Like, Rasulullah SAW did not tell directly, but his practice saying that Ramadan is the best time for i'tikaf. Why? Because we know that in Ramadan, Allah doubled the ajr. So I mean, when you do something in Ramadan, the ajr will be doubled than the other time. Another hadith also عن عائشة أنها كانت ترجل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهي حائض وهو معتكف في المسجد وهي في حجرتها يناولها رأسه وكان لا يدخل البيت إلا لحاجة و الحديث من عائشة saying while الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم من اعتكاف because you know during the Rasulullah ﷺ time the masjid was beside the rooms of the wife of Rasulullah ﷺ. So and all these rooms have a door to the masjid. So means Rasulullah ﷺ, when he come out of any door of his wife's, immediately he will be inside the masjid. So while Rasulullah ﷺ mu'takif, he go to his Aisha room and he give his head to Aisha inside her room and she comb his hair. Okay? And Aisha said sometimes she do that while she have the period. So that mean that it's okay for the mu'takif to take part of his body out but not all the body. So if part of the body go out of the masjid, that will not break the i'tikaf. Because this hadith Rasulullah takes his head out. So this means if while we do i'tikaf, if part of our body go out of the masjid, that will not break the i'tikaf. And also from that hadith we understand that during the i'tikaf, if the woman touches the man, it is okay. Because Aisha touching the Rasulullah and comb his hair. So it is another And then also breaking wudu. If during the Mecca, the wudu break. So still the i'tikaf on. That will not break the i'tikaf. And then during the i'tikaf to go to toilet is okay, because that will not break the i'tikaf. And also from this hadith we understand that a wife should take care of the man, of her husband. when he do for some job or he doing something, so it is good for the wife to go to and take care of her husband. Like, you know, Aisha here, she's combed the hair of Rasulullah while he's in i'tikaf. While in our life, the whole my life, my wife never combed my hair. you got the idea. I mean, the idea here, this one, it is not only ibadah, but also social relation. It will strengthen the relation between husband and wife. If the wife take care of her husband, for example, she know do his clothes or his hair or something, that one would strengthen the relation between them. So this is what we understand from that. Any questions? Also, another hadith, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu قال قلت يا رسول الله إني كنت نذرت في الجاهلية أن أعتكف ليلة وفي رواية يوم في المسجد الحرام قال فأوفي بنذرك. The hadith means Umar ibn al-Khattab, he told the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, يا رسول الله, before Islam I make nadhar. Nadhar, you know nadhar? Means, yeah, I said I will do that for Allah. So you make a promise, you practice ibadah for Allah. Like you make nadhar, I will fast one day, or I pay zakat, or whatever. So you make a promise to yourself to do something for Allah, that's why we call it nadhar. So that's why if you promise to do that, you have to do it. It is compulsory, you have no choice. And then Umar al-Khattab, he said, Ya Rasulullah, this is before Islam. I mean, when he was a kafir, he made that nadhar, but he did not do. So Rasulullah said, go and do it. Awfi bi nadhri. So means when promised to do a good things, so does it matter? You have to do it. Because you already promised to do a good thing. It is not bad. Okay? So when you promise to do a good things, so then you go and do it. Some of the ulama said Rasulullah told him to do that not because he doing what called a promise as a kafir, but because the Rasulullah wanted to encourage him to do good things. Because when he was a kafir, even he makes nadhar, is not accepted, because he already kafir. So the deed will be accepted only after La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Before that will not be accepted, right? So how then Umar, before that he is not a Muslim. But some of the ulama explained that, said it's okay, because the Rasulullah wanted to encourage people to do good things. So mean now, if also for us, if we make another, we have to do it. So if you promise, because some people they, when they are, for example, yes, madam, some people what they do, for example, when they are in trouble or they are in the crisis, oh Allah, just help me out, I will do something, and then after that they will forget. No, if you promise Allah to do, you have to do it. You have no choice. Because Allah will ask you the day after, you promise me to do that. So what is your answer would be, right? If Allah asks you the day after about it, so what is the answer would be? So that's why if you promise Allah to do, please go and do it. Okay? That's what you understand from the hadith.
Any exception, sir?
No exception.
No exception.
Unless the ulama, they said, for example, you promise to give money, but after that you become poor. Or for example, you promise Allah to fast, and after that you got sick and you have no money to pay. Because if you want to fast, but you cannot fast, you have to pay money for that, right? So I promise Allah, for example, to fast 10 days, and after that I got sick and I am poor. So, means no choice. But if you have choice, none, you have to do it. No exception. How about
the Nazar of the dead person?
The his people have to do. Oh. It's not have, but I mean to say if you love that person. Because Allah will ask that person, right? If that person died and he did not fulfill the promise, he will be asked the day after. If you love that person, help.
But if we have a certain nazar and we are dying already, can we pass it to our children?
What do you mean?
Let's say I promise to pay a certain amount and I haven't paid.
This is a debate here. A lot of ulama, they say, if we are sure 100% there is another, means there is a witness, there is another, we take it from his wealth before we divide the money to the warith. But this is a debate here, okay? That's why I say, but ulama, a lot of ulama, they say, if we sure he do that nadar, I mean there is a witness, people say yes he do that nadar, then we take it from his money and then we distribute that, because it is like dain. It's like dain. I mean if we have debt before they pay to the warith, right? They have to pay the debt, right? So that's why those ulama they say nadar is a dain. So we have to do it. Okay, another hadith which is عن صفية بنت حيي رضي الله عنها قالت كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم معتكفا فأتيته أزوره ليلا فحدثته ثم قمت لينقلب فقام معي ليقلبني وكان مسكنها في دار أسامة بن زيد فمر الرجلان من الأنصار فلما رأي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أسرع فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على رسلكما إنها صفية بنت حيي فقال سبحان الله يا رسول الله فقال إن الشيطان يجري من ابن آدم مجرى الدم وإني خشيت أن يقذف في قلوبكما شرا أو قال شيئا. Okay, this hadith, the wife of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, Safiya bint Huyay. You know Safiya bint Huyay. Her father was Jewish. And when Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم demolished Bani Qurayza, and he killed the man, Rasulullah married her, and she became a Muslim, and she became the wife of Umm al-Mu'mineen. And then during Ramadan, Rasulullah was i'tikaf in the masjid. So at night, she went to the masjid to chat with Rasulullah. And she sat with him around 1 hour, chatting with him. And after that, she wanted to go back, because it is night, Rasulullah accompanied her to sit here to her room. Because her room, Safiya, was not around the masjid. It is with the Osama bin Zayd house. So this means Rasulullah take her to the house. So on the road, there is two Sahaba was passed by. And when they saw Rasulullah with that lady, because you know at night they don't know who is the lady. So they go fast. And Rasulullah said, call them. Hey, come here. This is my wife, Safiya. He informed her. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, subhanAllah, yani, we did not doubt you, you are Rasulullah. He said, no, because I know Iblis can go to your brain and whisper. Maybe he will do something and maybe you think bad. So better to be in the safe side. So from that hadith, we can understand many things. First, that when someone in the i'tikaf, in the masjid, it's okay if people visited him or here and chat with him. It's okay. Like for example, I am in the masjid i'tikaf, my students want to come, or my family to come, or my relative or any friend want to visit me in the masjid or i'tikaf, it's okay, no problem with that. Because Safiya visited him and chat with him around 1 hour. This is one what we understand from the hadith. And second, what we understand also, this is his wife. So means when the wife visiting her husband in the masjid will not consider as shahwa or as desire, this is normal. Because some people, oh no, i'tikaf, when your wife, you know, it is increase the shower, you know, people, you know, become muttaqi more than Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Okay? We tell him, no, it is okay, because this is what the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam practiced. You are not more taqwa than Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is okay. And then what we also understand from when someone visits you and want to go back, it is nice to accompany him to, for example, to his car, if you have a car, okay? Don't just buy from your house. For example, going to his car, you know, accompany him to his car. This one will make the social relation between people better. And so, like Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, even his wife, but still he accompany her to the house. And then what we understand from protect yourself from what the people see. Means when you do something and people saw you, explain to them. Don't let it to their understanding. Because maybe they understand wrongly and then they will spread the fitna in the society. So better to clarify. So please, this is, okay, for example. Because, okay, but sometimes, for example, you are in the market with a woman. So people will see, okay, who is this woman? Or maybe people will talk, you know. So better if you say, Assalamu alaikum, for example, this is my cousin. I am taking her to the hospital or to the, whatever, why you are with this friend. So just explain to people that will not misunderstand and, you know, spread the fitna in the society. Even in Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, still he told them, hey, this is my wife. Don't think something else. Huh? So this is what we understand from the hadith. If you have any... Ah, there's another hadith. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was going out, for example, for Salat Janazah, to visit a sick person. This one all considered not breaking the i'tikaf. Because the ulama said, when anything necessary make you have to go out of the masjid, you can't go do that and come back, this one will not break your i'tikaf. But it should be necessary. Or for example, just to say, I am in the masjid and my wife called me, your son sick. So I just go home, take him to the clinic, send him back, then I go back to my i'tikaf. So that will not break the i'tikaf. It is necessary. Okay? Or for example, my friend called me, he got accident. So he needs someone to go with him to, for example, take him to the hospital or what health. So if I go and do that and come back to the i'tikaf, this one will not break the i'tikaf. Now a new chapter, Al-Hajj. New chapter, Al-Hajj. Hadith number 212. عن عبد الله بن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وقت لأهل المدينة ذا الحليفة ولأهل الشام الجحفة ولأهل نجد قرن المنازل ولأهل اليمن يلملم هن لهم ولمن أتى عليهم من غير أهلهن من أراد الحج والعمرة ومن كان دون ذلك فمن حيث أنشأ حتى أهل مكة من مكة. This hadith Ibn Abbas deciding the place when we have to wear ihram. So this places is to each area have a different place, like Ahlul Madina, Dhul Hulayfa. Place name is Dhul Hulayfa. For example, Ahlul Sham, Juhfa. Ahlul Najd, Qarn al-Manazil. Ahlul Yemen, Yalamla. So this four different directions, from south, from north, from east, from west. This is a different four places. So this means if you come from this any direction, this is your what call your ihram or miqat. So that's why our ulama, they make a circle around. Okay. So let us say the ihram is. This is Makkah. So this is ihram here. Now miqat, this is the miqat. So our ulama, what they do circle around that. So this means when you come from anywhere, when you reach that border, you have to. That's why, for example, when we come with the aircraft, it is not necessary. Yeah, it is not necessary. We come directly on that place, right? Because let us say, okay, Malaysia here, and one miqat here, one miqat here, right? So the craft come, aircraft come from here. The aircraft will not come here because of the miqat, right? So that's why what our ulama, they do a circle around it. So this means when you cross that border here, you have to wear your ihram. So doesn't matter you come from which country, still there is a place for you to wear your ihram. So this is how what Al-Abbas. And also we have to understand that we have no choice. Means when you reach that place, then you have to wear the ihram. Because this is the place when you cannot cross without wearing ihram. And when you wear ihram, later inshallah, we'll see what we have to do. So you cannot put perfume anymore, you cannot, all these things. Okay. Yes.
How did
it
come up that for
miqat? Rasulullah told us.
Specifically?
Yes, specifically. He said if you come from Yemen, so you yalablam. Because at that time the road from Yemen to Mecca, they have to cross that area, they call yalablam. So yalablam become a miqat because Rasulullah said yalablam. Why yalablam? Allahu a'lam. No one, Rasulullah did not mention to us why it is yalablam. Okay, let us say I am inside the border. They said if you are from, if you are inside the border, from your house. You wear the ihram in your house anyway. Like Mecca, like Jeddah, for example.
You're
already inside. So there is no miqat. And then, this is why the problem with the Umrah. When people go to Umrah and they want to do another Umrah. You get the idea? Okay, now, okay, let us say this is Mecca. Okay? This is Mecca. Kaaba is here, and this is Mecca. Okay, now, for example, if you come from north, for example, this is your miqat. If you come from south, for example, this is your miqat. East, here, west, for example, here. So this is the miqat, become like that, right? So this is the miqat. So now, if you cross this miqat from anywhere, you have to wear ihram. Okay? So now I am already in Mecca, I do my umrah. Khalas, habit, finish. Now I want to do another umrah. What I should do?
According to what is saying, you have to go back
out. So now whether they take them to Al-Tan'im or they call them to another one which is around 30 kilometers, something like that. Which is wrong. Yeah, because the miqat, you have to go back to the miqat, which is the nearest miqat around 80 kilometers. The nearest miqat to Mecca is around 80 kilometers.
So,
if you are in Mecca and you want to go to the nearest miqat of this one, which is around 80 kilometers. So that's why when you go to Al-Tan'im is not a miqat. You got the idea? So why people go to Al-Tan'im? Because there is a story. And our ulama talk about the story. Because when Aisha did a hajj with the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when they go to Mecca, she have her period. While there is another wife of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they don't have the period. So what they do Umrah first, and then they do Hajj. Aisha, because of the period, cannot do Umrah. And she only do Hajj. You got the idea? So then when they finish the Hajj, they want to go back, you know, the woman jealousy. Is this woman jealousy work? She told him, Ya Rasulullah, your wife, otherwise, they do Umrah and Hajj with you, I do only Hajj. So, Rasulullah asked her brother Abdul Rahman, go with your sister back. That time they was in that area. Go with your sister back, let her to do Umrah. And then Aisha went back, she do Umrah with Abdul Rahman, and then she followed Rasulullah. And then people said, okay, since Aisha do from that place, this means we also can do. We also can do. So all of us say, no, this is a special case for Aisha. It has nothing to do with the other. It's a special case with Aisha. And then if your case like Aisha, you can do it. But if your case not like Aisha, you cannot do it. Like women have a period, cannot do in the beginning of the Hajj. And then after the Hajj, you can do. Why? Because same with Aisha. But now you are not the same, right? You do your Umrah completely. Now you want to do another Umrah. So you are not a special case. Mean you have no necessary things here force you to do that, right? Then you have to do it normal way. What is the normal way? Go back to the Miqat. So you have to go back to Miqat here, wear the Ihram and go back.
So we have been doing Ihram.
Yeah, this is the problem.
Only advice. I know. So what happened?
Because this is the problem, they want to entertain you. So some people, they do 3 Umrah, 4 Umrah, 5 Umrah.
So the only Umrah
is... Do you know what Imam Malik said? Doing Umrah in 1 year twice, not accepted. Even you do it, will not consider Umrah. Imam Malik. Said because he said the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he can do Umrah more than that, and he did not do.
Did that.
Yes, and he can do it. While he can do it, he did not do. Now you want to tell me that you are
better
than Muhammad or what? Sorry?
Shafi'i,
yes, you can do, it's okay, but still you have to go to the Miqat. There is some ulama, they say, because that's why there's some ulama say you can do it from a Tana'i.
But not Shafi'i.
You have to go to Miqat.
So
for example, Ibn Awr Ulama, Ibn Uthaymeen, and Abdullah ibn Zimbaz, they have disagreement on that. But majority of the ulama, they said, you need to go to Miqat. You have to go back to Miqat.
So, all
Islam
first prayer is okay.
But still, if you want to do wrong Tan'im, I cannot say it is wrong. Because some of the ulama say that.
Yeah.
But what I am saying, majority of the ulama did not accept that.
Majority says no.
Yeah. So be careful with that.
And the fact that Shafi'i says no.
I don't know Shafi'i exactly what the Shafi'i said. Yeah, so that's why I cannot. Majority of the ulama said you have to go to Miqat. You have to start your ihram from Miqat. Sorry? The nearest Miqat is 80 kilometers. Sorry?
What's the name of the Miqat?
Miqat, I think of the Medina Dhul Hulayfa or something like that. I forgot the name.
I remember it was...
But in Mecca, there is a lot of taxi can take you to that Miqat. It takes around 1 hour.
Yeah, I went there once.
Yeah.
There's
a place where it was. Yeah. It doesn't take 1 hour, 1.5 hours. Go, I'll come back, maybe 1 to 1.5 hour, maybe. Which is not that far. So, but that one will make you in safe side, more safe side. Okay, 2 years ago I went to the Umrah with my wife. She wants to do more Umrah. I said, no, don't do. For me, yeah, this is my fatwa to my family. because I'm not Mufti, so...
So it's only for your mother.
Yeah. But my wife told me, she wants to do, I said, no, don't do it. Don't do it. If you want to do, we have to go back and do another Umrah again. By the way, doing a lot of Umrah is not Sunnah. Some people say, yeah, okay, everyone like to go to Mecca. But don't tell me that you like Mecca more than Muhammad. Because Muhammad confirmed to us by Hadith, he said the most lovely place to my heart is Mecca. When Rasulullah said that, no one can claim he loved Mecca more than Muhammad, right? Because he's Rasulullah, and he said the most loving place to my heart is Mecca. He loved Mecca more than anyone else, and he can do more Umrah, and he did not do.
So we need to say that if you go for one package, how many people will try at least three Umrah in Colombia?
Why? My question, why? Yeah, more if we encourage to do more. For example, when you pray, Qiyamul Layl, Allah encourages us to pray more. Then here the more is the better, right? But for the Umrah, did Allah encourage you to go more? this is the question. Yeah, that's even Rasul can do more than that, right? Yeah. So why Rasul did not do?
Then what did he do instead?
Sorry?
What did he do instead in the time?
He just do Umrah one time and he go back.
Then go back.
Yeah. That's it. My professor, his wife, she did maybe 13, 14 Umrah in one visit. Sometimes she do Umrah twice a day. This is one for my father, this one for my mother, this one for my grandfather, this one. And she go to hotel and come back, she go to hotel and come back. Till she collapsed.
Thank you. Is that for somebody else?
Sorry? Yeah, she do that. She said, this one for my mother, for example. This Umrah for my father, this Umrah for... And she do around 13 or 14 and she collapsed.
Is that allowed to dedicate to someone?
Yeah, of course we can.
The question here is that... For yourself, it's only one time.
But this is the question. That's why, for example, some of the ulama, they say, instead of you go to Hajj twice, okay? If you have money, give to another one to go to Hajj. You will get the same ajr of